Psalms as Poetry. This podcast will talk about reading the Psalms as poetry. Psalms are poetic compositions, and they fall under a particular category of literature, that is, lyric poetry, as mentioned in the previous podcast. How to explore this concept? We ask questions like, what is a psalm? Now, the first way to answer that question is to identify the features that make up a psalm as a composition, which is presented to us as text. What elements constitute a psalm's identity, and what basic dimensions of a text should the reader recognize as a foundation or a starting point for understanding the text? Now, since what we're asking about is typical of all psalms, then one psalm can serve as an illustration for the rest. So, by way of introduction, let's look at Psalm 3, the third psalm, and let's analyze it. And this portion of the podcast might well be called The Anatomy of a Psalm. Now, at times I hesitate doing this to a psalm, that is, breaking it apart for analysis. It would be like taking a beautiful flower and removing its individual parts for study. Nonetheless, I still think that this exercise of analysis is vital for a psalm study, as long as in the end the reader understands that he or she has to step back to appreciate the psalm as a whole. So let's look at Psalm 3. Psalm 3, a psalm of David, when he fled from his son Absalom. Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But you, Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head high. I call out to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy mountain. I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear, though tens of thousands assail me on every side. Arise, Lord, deliver me, my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people. Okay, so the text of Psalm 3 is composed of a heading in the psalm itself. In most versions of the Bible, the heading, also called the superscription, is printed in a different type to distinguish it from the psalm. This heading, or title, gives information about the psalm. In this text, Psalm 3, it says that the psalm belongs to David, or is of David, and was used when he fled from his son Absalom. Psalms have headings. Well, at least two-thirds of the psalms are introduced by headings. Of the 150 psalms in our Bibles, only 34 lack superscriptions of any kind. That's in the Hebrew text. And only 17 in the Septuagint, or the pre-Christian Greek translation of the Old Testament. So, most psalms have headings. And those psalms that do not have headings are the so-called orphan psalms, and they're found mainly in books 3 and 4 in the larger organizational structure of the psalms. So the headings give us information about the psalm we're about to read. So a psalm has structure. It's not a mishmash of random lines. And most English Bibles have the translation of a psalm with indents and lines. There's structure there. In Psalm 3, verse 1, we'll notice, is composed of two short clauses. The first clause, Lord, how many are my foes, is followed by the second clause, how many rise up against me. The clause or phrase in poetry is called a colon. That's the technical term. Plural, cola. And so, Lord, how many are my foes, is one colon, and how many rise up against me is another colon. So we see here that the Psalms do exhibit structure, and this will be explored later on. Not only do they have structure, but Psalms also have rhythm or meter, two very related terms. Meter and rhythm in poetry have to do with patterns and recurrences in sound. The famous poem by Joyce Kilmer starts, "I think that I shall never see a poem lovely as a tree." You see the pattern there? There's rhythm from just that line. Now in Psalms, this is best understood by considering the accents, not in the English, but in the Hebrew. Although the accents may also be heard to some degree in translation. Let me read to you Psalm 3 in Hebrew. I'll just read the first verse. Yahweh ma rabu tsarai, rabim kamim alai. Do you hear the pattern there? There's rhythm. There's meter. That was verse 1 in the English. Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? As you listen to the Hebrew, now you also realize this is the reason why it's easy to chant the Psalms, both in English and in the Hebrew. Consider another Psalm. Let's turn to Psalm 19, and I'll read another line in the Hebrew. Torat Yahweh temima meshivat nafesh. Edut Yahweh ne'emana machimat peti. Did you notice the sound pattern? Patam, 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 patam. Now let's listen to that excerpt from Psalm 19 in the English. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and righteous altogether. It's pretty much the same meter. Patam, 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 patam. So rhythm and meter can be identified in both the Hebrew and also in the English. So much for rhythm and meter. Let's move on to rhyme. If someone asks what makes a poem, most people will talk about rhyme. Typically, we expect poems to rhyme. Rhyme makes poems sound better and easier to remember. Think about Edgar Allan Poe and the line, "From childhood hour I have not been, as others were I have not seen." Or the one from Joyce Kilmer that we just mentioned, "I think that I shall never see a poem lovely as a tree." First and second lines rhyme. But then you can have, for a stanza, you could have first and third lines match, and the second and fourth lines match, such as this one from Robert Frost. "I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in the wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference." Sigh rhymes with by, and hence rhymes with difference. These are some famous lines of Western poetry, and they rhyme. Now, poetry of the Semitic kind, that is, of the language family of Hebrew, differs from most Western poetry in that it does not rhyme the way we expect. Instead, as we shall see, there is rhyming of thought, thought rhyme, dual thoughts. And this brings us to primary aspect of Hebrew poetry, parallelism. Hebrew poetry tends to come in related pairs. Let's talk a little bit about terms. In Hebrew poems, the short clause or a short sentence is called a colon, and two cola combine to make what is technically called a line. Now, occasionally, 3 colo will make a line, 4 colo in exceptional cases. But most of the time, it's a pair of colon, 2 colo. In most printed Bibles, the second colon of a line is slightly indented relative to the first. And if a line has a third or fourth colon, these follow suit. Related lines are then combined into strophes or short stanzas similar to Western poetry. Let's look back at Psalm 3 for an example. Verse 1 goes, Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Lord, how many are my foes? That's the first colon. So colon 2 is saying pretty much the same thing as colon 1. Now, both cola make up the first verse. Verse 1 is therefore one line, and one line is assigned to one verse. Now, this is not always the case. A line does not necessarily constitute one verse, and the two should not be confused. In many psalms, there is assigned a verse number per colon, hence 2 verses in one line. A difference is found in Psalm 51, verse 4, where 2 lines constitute one verse. So Psalm 51, 4, Against you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. That's 2 lines, which constitute 1 verse. So, to review, the psalmist used a short sentence or clause called the colon as their primary building block. The cola need not rhyme. Instead, there is rhyming of thought. Successive cola are paired, you could say rhymed, to make a point or deliver an idea. So there's a shadowing of clauses. And this is a fundamental Hebrew literary device. One German scholar comments, you hear things in stereophonic. That is from 2 sides. It's in stereo. I like that description of Hebrew poetry. I'd like to end by explaining some different types of parallelism. Now, the following descriptions might get a bit technical, but I encourage you to just make your way through them. And I'm sure in the future, as you get more familiar with the Psalms, then you'll be more appreciative of these kinds of parallelism, and you'll notice them as you read. The 3 basic types of parallelism can be seen in Psalms. There's what we call synonymous parallelism, which uses 2, or sometimes 3 or 4, but at least 2 colo to express similar thoughts. Let me read to you Psalm 70, verse 1. Hasten, O God, to save me. O Lord, come quickly to help me. So the first and second cola say the same thing, just like we saw in Psalm chapter 3, verse 1. A lot of Psalms actually begin with synonymous parallelism. You can also check out Psalm 24, verse 1 and 2, as well as Psalm 16, verse 5 and 6. So that's synonymous parallelism. A second type is antithetic parallelism, which uses cola with contrasting thoughts. The first and second are different. First colon in Psalm chapter 1, verse 6 says, For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous. And that's followed by second colon, but the way of the wicked will perish. So you see the contrast there. Let me read Psalm 37, verse 8. Calm your anger and forget your rage. Do not fret. It only leads to evil. So you see the contrast right there. Now, when the second colon builds on the thought of the first one, this is called synthetic parallelism. We find this in Psalm chapter 2, verse 6. I have installed my king on Zion, my holy hill. And so he's introduced Zion in the first colon, and then he explains further by saying that's his holy hill in the second colon. Let's check Psalm 29, verse 1. It says, "Ascribe to the Lord, O mighty ones, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength." A similar phenomenon right there. So the sense or content of the measures or the kola in a line is parallel. In one way or another, the sense of the second colon and the third, if there is one, corresponds to that of the first, and their relationship is defined by what kind of parallelism the Hebrew writer wishes. And sometimes there is parallelism even between lines. The ways in which the parallels work cannot be reduced to a few categories, and that's why some scholars don't consider just these three types of parallelism, but just conclude that in Hebrew poetry, the succeeding kola always build on the previous colon. That is, there is a compounding effect. So some contemporary scholars would rather focus on this effect. They look at the second colon and ask, what did the Hebrew writer add in this second colon in order to explain the first? Or how is he explaining the first through the addition of the second or even the third colon? So these contemporary scholars would rather look at the difference between the first and second colon and would rather not define which kind of parallelism it is. Let's review. We saw that Psalms can be analyzed as poetry. They are poetic compositions. They have structure. They're not random lines. And aside from structure, they have rhythm or meter. And then we also introduced parallelism as a main feature of Semitic poetry. When reading Psalms, we ought to bear in mind that the thoughts generally come in pairs. We need to consider the parallel thoughts in order to grasp the fuller meaning. In the next podcast, we'll look at some other aspects of Hebrew poetry.